Hi, good evening. Welcome to New America. So we're going to begin the kind of presentation this evening. I'm Peter Bergen. I, with Awista Ayoub over here, direct the Fellows Program. And Constantine has also been instrumental in managing the program. He's a former fellow, and we're going to hear from him about his experience, and Jay Newton Small, who writes for Time and is starting her second book as a fellow here, writing about Alzheimer's, and Ted Johnson, who was a recent White House fellow, a White House fellow, and then the speechwriter for the joint for the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, expert on cybersecurity, former military officer who is writing a book about African American voting behavior. So they will talk, I'll talk for a short bit, they will talk longer about their experiences of being a fellow, what it meant, how it's helped them with their work, their experience of the application process. But let me just give you a very quick 30,000 foot view. New America was founded in 1999. It's a nonpartisan think tank. It was founded largely by a bunch of journalists. So journalism is in our DNA. And part of the theory of the Fellows Program is that we want to communicate big and interesting ideas in a way that a lot of people will find out about them, because obviously that's more effective than few people finding out about them. And we find that people who write in English, it's helpful if they can write in English well. We've published probably 35 first books of authors, which probably published about 70 books overall. We also are supporting documentary filmmakers, photographers. We have, for the first time this year, we supported a novelist. We don't ask you to give up your day job necessarily. Almost everybody, I think, this year who's got a fellowship is doing other things at the same time. But we also do support some people full time if they decide to choose leave their job to take up a fellowship. This year, we've had one of the books of the year from the New York Times, Rosa Brooks, writing about the kind of collapse between war and peace and how the boundaries between war and peace have collapsed in the post 9/11 era. We have had a couple of Pulitzer Prize finalists in the last 3 years. Anand Gopal's book about Afghanistan, Fred Kaplan's book about counterinsurgency in the U.S. military. One of our recent picks, Lauren Redness, was subsequently awarded a MacArthur Award, a genius grant. The bad news for the purposes of applying is that last year we had 410 applications and we accepted 22 people, so the acceptance rate is 5%. And we turned away a number of very good projects, and Constantine was part of that process. The process is fairly, we read all the applications that come in. By design, the process is not onerous, so we expect you to put a huge amount of time into writing the application. It's 2,500 words at most, so often that's not a heavy lift. We narrow that down to 50. In that process, we often have people at New America peer review. It will be myself and Awista and Constantine who will take the first crack at it this year. If we don't have an area of if it's outside our area of expertise, we go to somebody who has an area of expertise at New America, and then we whittle that down to 50 finalists. We then have a group of 10 people consisting of former and present fellows. We might dragoon Ted and Jay into helping us with that, if they were so minded. And also Anne-Marie Slaughter. We then have a sort of scoring system that I think kind of excludes a lot of personal bias or favoritism, so that it's as rigorous a process as possible. And last year we took 22 people. This year I imagine we will take something similar. So having given that sort of brief overview of the process, I'm going to turn it over to Constantine and then Jay and then Ted to talk about their experience of being the fellow and how it's helped or not helped them with their work.
So I first came here 6 years ago, I guess, which have gone by quite quickly, as years tend to do. I came working on a project about basically how the government funds scientific research, looking at the fact that even people who are researchers funded by the government at NIH or at a university don't realize just how big a part this is of what the federal government does, because there's a lot of agencies that are sort of scattered around. So basically 10% of what the government spends, once you take aside Social Security and other entitlements, is scientific research. It's not a sort of incidental thing that, the government does. And that the fruits of that research then feed into the economy in the many ways that we're familiar with, of having the internet and mobile phones and antibiotics and many other things. So that was sort of my pitch to Steve Call at the time, and I wanted to sort of find a way not to just write a sort of like policy argument of how should this be done, but a sort of a narrative journalism through line about how the sort of tension between an individual researcher and the bureaucracy. I have many friends who are academics. I studied physics in university, and to a person, they all say that their grant applications are basically lies, which is something that you won't get if you just like go out and interview somebody who just like just published a paper in Science. But there's basically a lot of the funding agencies say that they want sort of innovation and risk taking, but actually they don't. They're quite conservative, so people tend to write in their applications things that they already know are true, and they use the applications to get the money, and then they work on something else that they're actually interested in, a strategy that I don't recommend to any of you in this application. So I wrote about a couple of researchers at NASA and sort of how they spent sort of 20 years of their lives chasing a dead end, basically, which was something that I think I would have had a very hard time doing without the support of the institution. But I was interested in sort of writing something that could reflect the actual sort of lived lives of scientists, which is, if you pick up a sort of copy of the New York Times on Tuesdays when the Science Times comes out, it's sort of breakthrough after breakthrough. This is true of sort of any magazine or newspaper about science, just because that's the bias that's built into the news. Like someone not discovering something is not news. And yet it's misleading because most of scientists' days are not like, oh, I made another breakthrough today. Like they come home after work. Most of their time is spent not discovering things. And I wanted to find a way to write about that. And that's a hard pitch to make to a magazine editor or a book editor. I was sort of happy with how that turned out, and I don't think I would have been able to do it without being here. So, and I'm grateful to have been here.
Did it turn into a book?
It turned into an ebook. So it was a Kindle single, I guess, which is a form that.
Mention your new project.
Yes. So I'm now working partially as an outgrowth of that book on a history of gravity, of sort of human understanding of gravity, focusing on the 20th century.
So my name is Jay Newton-Small. I've just left Time magazine about 2 months ago, although I remain a contributor indefinitely. I kind of came to New America at a funky time in my cycle, and they've actually really ended up helping me with two books instead of one. So I applied to be a fellow in 2015 for the 2016 year. At the time, I was just finishing my first book, which was published last January, called Broad Influence, How Women Are Changing the Way America Works. And that grew out of a Time story I did about the women of the Senate coming together during the government shutdown to restart the negotiations to reopen the government when none of the men would talk to each other. And the book actually looks at critical mass. So what happens when women reach somewhere between 20% and 30% in any body, whether it's a legislature like the Senate in that particular session, it was 20%, although they chaired 11 of the 20 committees. Or a corporate board, a Navy ship, or an appellate court. Turns out there's a huge body of research out there that shows that women really, it's a tipping point when they reach critical mass and they really begin to change the culture of those institutions. And so my book looks at all the places where they're reaching this tipping point and the differences that they're making, and then it looks at all the places where we're really far away from it and why we need to get there. I was super naive, I think, at what it would take to promote a book, and particularly, so I was like, oh, the book will come out in January, and I had already had in mind that I wanted to do a second book about caregiving, particularly on Alzheimer's and the coming cliff of caregiving and Alzheimer's and dementia. And that was what my pitch was about, to come to New America, was to write my second book. So I thought, you know, my first book will publish in January. I will, you know, promote it for a couple of months, and then I will start my second book. And here we are almost a year later, and I still have 24 events in the next 6 months for my first book. So I am really far behind on my second book, which my agent will tell you is very upsetting to him. New America was kind enough to renew me for a year, which is great. So now that I've finally left time and have time to focus on my second book and a related startup that I'm working on in the memory space and Alzheimer's and dementia called Memory Well, you know, I still have this wonderful net and this amazing group of people to count as resources. And so from my experience, they were amazing in helping promote my first book. And so that was ended up being a marathon. And I'm really lucky it turned into a bestseller. And it was, you know, we're on our third reprint now for its hardcover. And I had great interviews for it, like Hillary Clinton and Kellyanne Conway and a bunch of others. And so New America hosted events for me here in DC and an event in New York, which was amazing. We had like hundreds of people come to both. It was awesome. They were just really wonderful, like as a group of like resources of writers who'd been through similar experiences. So I don't know if I'd never written a book before, and I got to the point where I was like, okay, publicist, tell me where to go. And my publicist was like, well, no, you tell me what to do. And I was like, wait, I have no idea. And so my publicist, you know, so basically I went to all the New America fellows and said, where did you promote your book? and then I told my publicist, you need to book me here, 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 and here. And then that's what they did. So it was a great resource that way. And it was also just great, like, you know, with advice on what to do and where to spend your time. So, you know, I had a lot of great advice on where to place op-eds for my book and excerpts from my book and you know, who to approach to write about different things, and really great links, you know, like here's the name and email of the New York Times op-ed page guy, like you should email him and say, I told him to give you an email. Stuff like that. It was just a really invaluable resource and amazing. And I ended up writing, actually just recently, like a couple weeks ago, an op-ed with Anne-Marie about the election, which was awesome. It's been an amazing experience, and I can't recommend it highly enough. And now we get to go into book two.
All right, so as Peter mentioned, I am a newly retired career naval officer who's writing about African-American voting behavior. And these two things don't necessarily go together quite well. So I just started the fellowship in September of this past, a couple months ago. I'm a brand new fellow. A year ago, I was in your chair, active duty military officer, knowing that I wanted to do something other than the military after my career was over. And so, you know, black voting behavior, it's of interest to me for some obvious reasons. Came to the Navy just out of college, not really knowing what I wanted to do, and I sort of searched and searched for a purpose, and the Navy gave that to me. But then, in applying for the White House Fellowship, I had sort of had to come up with something else intriguing about myself other than my resume, because there are impressive people applying for that program just like this one. And so I started to dig into my family history and figure out the history behind my name. And my full name is Theodore Roosevelt Johnson III. And so I wanted to talk to my parents, like, why am I named after a Republican president from over a century ago? And so I started to dig a little bit. And as it turns out, my great-grandparents were fans of Teddy Roosevelt, primarily because he invited Booker T. Washington to the White House. It was the first time ever a black man had been invited to the White House on a social visit to dine with the president. And they were so inspired by this gesture that they decided to name their second son Theodore Roosevelt Johnson. And so I am the third, and as a White House fellow, I got to meet the first black president of the United States, you know, something that my great-grandparents probably would have never envisioned. But my father remained a Republican. From that family history, my mother is a Democrat. And if you pay any attention to politics, you know that 90% of black people vote for the Democratic candidate in presidential elections. But growing up in a house where there was both a black Republican, which is like the political unicorn that, you know, you never see, and a Democrat, I heard these conversations about the diversity of black voters and black America in general. So I decided I'm going to investigate this. I started to freelance write while I was still active duty. Just I would read something, it would make me angry, and I would write about it. And I'd pitch it to 100 places, and 99 would tell me no, but someone would say yes. And eventually the byline started to accumulate, and I realized I should probably get smarter on this stuff if I'm really gonna be an authority on it. So I went and got a doctorate in public policy, studying specifically how African-American votes do or do not turn into policy gains for the black community. And so when I showed up here last year, I was actually towards the end part of my dissertation data collection, finishing a military career and sort of on this personal quest for identity and wanting to answer the question or actually counter the argument that black people are a monolith when it comes to our voting. And so I showed up to New America with nothing but an idea and some freelance writing, and here I am. So it's, you don't have to have the book proposal. You don't even have to investigate something you've spent your life doing. You can just have a question that nags you and have some body of work to show that you can actually investigate it and make it intriguing, and then do the application and go. Since then, I was able to workshop the idea, my application essentially, with the fellows at a retreat. I wrote a prologue. I workshopped it here in the building a couple of weeks ago, and they beat it up pretty good, and now I'm rewriting. I aspire to hold a panel where I bring in experts from the field to New America to talk about black America voting behavior post-Obama in the Trump era, and this is all good stuff for my book. So I will leave the end of this first year without a book, without a doubt. I hope if I leave here with a proposal and an agent that's interested, that's a victory for me. And this could only be possible with the time and resources that New America has made available to a Navy officer who wants to write about political science.
Well, thank you very much, Ted. And we are joined now by Ramesh Ratnasar, who has a busy day job as Chief of Staff at the State Department for the Undersecretary for Public Policy. He was also a fellow here. He's worked for Bloomberg. He's worked for Business Week. He's written for pretty much every newspaper on the planet.
And for Time.
Time. Sorry, how could I possibly forget that? So Ramesh, tell us a little bit about your experience of being a fellow here and kind of what anything you felt might be useful to communicate to people here.
Yes, my apologies for running a little late. I was a fellow in 2010 through 2011, and I predominantly used the fellowship to embark on a book project that remains unfinished. I'm sad to say, but you know, it's out there, and I'm sure there's other people in the room who probably fall in the same. Fall in the same boat, but the project was a book looking at a sort of narrative history of August of 1945, the aftermath of the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki leading up to the surrender on September 2nd on board the USS Missouri. I also used the fellowship to work as a foreign policy columnist for Time. I wrote a weekly column on foreign policy and was greatly informed by a lot of the conversations I had here at New America. I mean, it was a somewhat informal fellowship at the time. I think there were about 8 to 10 folks who were here as Schwartz Fellows. Some were sort of in residence, so they had office space and they were more or less here every day. Others like me were able to use some office space at New America. We weren't here every day. We weren't sort of in residence, but there were weekly get-togethers with all the fellows. There were the fellows' lunches in which folks would present their work, their ongoing research. And I think there was just a sort of, it became a kind of community of ideas and within, you know, the larger New America community. And I'd have to say that the biggest thing I derived from the fellowship is the relationship that I have had with New America since then. So I actually basically left that fellows program and joined Bloomberg as a deputy editor of Business Week, but I remained a future tense fellow, essentially a non-resident fellow at New America. While I worked at Business Week, I continued to participate in events. in New York and in Washington, I think just maintain close relationships with a lot of the folks who are in my fellows class. And I have to say that as an editor, that was paid huge dividends because I employed some of those people, like Charles Kenny, who's sitting back there. but it, as also just as a as an individual, as a journalist, as somebody who's interested in ideas, I was able to basically expose myself to an incredible group of people who focus on a really wide range of public policy issues, and I continue to derive great benefits from that. So I think that to me is really what the fellowship has meant. That is the biggest thing that I've derived from the fellowship, in addition to just the sort of general support for my writing and research.
Well, thank you. So we'll open it to questions. If you have a question, just raise your hand and wait for the mic. And we're going to broadcast this later for other people who couldn't make it. So just wait for the mic before you ask your question. And if you can identify yourself, that would also be helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. That was great. Thank you. Joan Michelson, Green Connections Media. A couple of questions. One is, when we give you our 2,500 words or less, do you then at any time say, well, we love this part of the idea, but can you flip it over and turn it purple? I mean, do you tweak the idea? Do you give feedback in that way? Or do you just, is it an all or nothing?
I mean, it is 410 applications, so it's hard to... you can ask us questions as you have my email, you have a Weister's email. We're very available to have a discussion about what you're doing, but I think it would be, you should submit what you want to do and, not presume that we're going to ask you for a rewrite.
Okay, and just a quick follow-up. How much of your ability to market the book or the film or the documentary goes into the decision to be chosen as a fellow?
Not at all.
Thanks. Richard Jordan from the Royal Academy of Science International Trust and from New York. Are the total number of successful applicants equally divided between New York and Washington? Because I've been to several events at the new New York space. And how does that work? Are there off-site, I just heard, fellows? On-site fellows, could you be a little more specific on the breakup?
Yeah, we don't have a residential requirement. We have an office in New York. We have an office here. We have an office in San Francisco. We're opening in Chicago. Our fellows, many of them are in Brooklyn because, of course, a lot of talent is in Brooklyn. Many are here in Washington and elsewhere. So there's no kind of we've moved away from a more residential model to a more whatever works for you model.
Hi, I'm Tara McKelvey. I work for the BBC. Can you tell us more about what you were saying about the process when you're here? You talked about the meetings that you have. It'd be really helpful to know about the support that you get while you're working on a book.
Ted.
Yeah, so there, I mean, as far as mandatory meetings and requirements, there are really none. At the beginning of the year, the fellows will get together and do a retreat so you can meet each other and sort of talk about your idea in front of new people and describe it. But then after that, we talk about the progress we've made on our project throughout the course of the year over lunches. So fellows will tune into that either online or by phone or in attendance. But that's almost it. There is no weekly Friday meeting or no requirement for you to be in the building a certain number of days. So that flexibility allows the majority of us to pursue other things during the day, but still leverage the network that is always available to you, just an email or so away. Additionally, you can request, so like I mentioned, I requested a workshop to workshop one of the chapters I had written. And I think maybe 7 or 8 folks showed up, not just fellows, but also New America experts in political science, et cetera. And then you also have the ability to convene panels to help develop your idea or people, experts you want to talk to, and you are able to leverage the clout that New America has to bring those people in. So the mandatory piece, like I said, it's almost non-existent, but it's always available to you to leverage to make, sort of further your idea.
Anne Plant, I'm from the National Institute of Standards and Technology, and I'm curious about what you say about resources. Does New America provide funding to bring people in, experts in, to talk about ideas?
So sometimes I think is the right answer. I think it depends. Mostly not. If you want to fly in five people to come hold a panel here as a fellow, that probably won't happen. But they will give you the space. That's what your stipend is for. You can use your stipend to bring those folks in. The resources, really the value, are the other fellows and the expertise at New America, the space, the brand. And there was something else I was going to say that I've forgotten. But the resources are beyond just the monetary piece of it. It's the whole package.
I'm a part of my fellowship is with the Better Life Lab. So I kind of split my time between the regular fellows and the Better Life Lab, which is focused on caregiving. It's the former caregiving and breadwinning sort of cone of New America. And they're a group of experts who are working on the various issues that I'm actually looking at particularly. And so my next book is actually about, like I said, the coming cliff of caregiving in terms of elder care and the sandwich generation. And they're actually building a sort of index of care for elders right now. So I've been working with them on that, and they've been an amazing resource for me, just with like AARP and other groups in town who are also thinking about these issues.
I might quickly take your question as a sort of opportunity to answer a sort of slightly broader question, which is the sort of relationship, which Jay's remarks just provoke that in my head, the sort of relationship between the fellows program here and the policy programs we have in specific areas. New America, as you can see, it's not a small place these days. It is not a place, however, that covers all things that are important in public policy. There are many things that are of vital importance to the nation and to the world where we do not have an established policy program because we don't have aspirations to be comprehensive. That is basically neither here nor there, but in an interesting way for the fellows, in that if you have a project that's on an area in which New America does work, it's potentially a beneficial synergy, saying, oh, we do something, here's somebody who's thinking about these same questions in a different way. If you're working in an area which is important, but New America doesn't have an established program, that's also a virtue in some ways of, this is important, we should be doing more about this, we don't have something already, and here's a way to bring someone in. The Fellows Program historically has been, I think, Peter first came here as a fellow. That's true of many of the program staff here as well, particularly in areas where we don't have something already. It's potentially a way, and depending on what other outside commitments people maintain, this isn't something that happens automatically, but it's something that if you have an interest in developing a program, that's one conceivable outlet. And going to your question about sort of funding of organizing forums, the policy programs here, as Jay mentioned, the Better Life Lab, part of their remit is to bring in people and organize things. It's just we have a large number of fellows the fellows program itself doesn't generally do that, but you can partner with programs that do, you can take an initiative in organizing things. And we are, located in D.C. where there's quite a lot of people who are local. And in terms of organizing events for people where there's not a travel overhead, the sky's the limit, basically finding when this room is available and organizing things.
And yeah, and so that raises a point, which is, let's say you had a proposal that was in the education space. It would be kind of strange not to reference relevant work that was done here. It's not mandatory, but it would be strange if you didn't, because it would be like, well, aren't you aware that, Kevin Carey's views on, the future of college are relevant to your work. So it would behoove your application, if you were at least aware of work being done here, if it had any bearing on what you're talking about, just to say something like, it would be great to, collaborate with X, Y, or Z.
Which is not to say that there is a, you should parrot what's being done here already. You should just engage with it in some form, and, productive disagreement is the, spice of life in this institution.
Are there any questions on that side? No? Okay. Just pass here.
Good evening. My name is Brian Holland. I don't know if this is true of anyone else in the audience, but it's true of me. There are a few ideas that are circulating in my head. Some of them are aligned, some of them are non-complementary. For someone who has different ideas passing through, what in some ways is your recommendation? That you give it your best shot with one idea that you've developed, or and you know,
I 2,500 words. I would do, you know, in general, I would do the idea you actually want to do and that you think is the best one, rather than produce five ideas that you might want to do, because it's hard to sort of, you won't be able to elaborate them very clearly in if there's five of them compared to just one idea. I mean, you know, we've had people come up with one big idea and say, I am interested in this other thing that we have accepted, but typically it's like, it's an idea that's developed that is coherent and isn't just a bunch of ideas that I seem to have at a particular moment.
Hi, I'm Louise. I'm a producer with French Television here in DC. I have two questions about the applications. First question is, would you say you should focus more on the general idea of what you wanted to do, or about what you were planning to do during the fellowship? So more about the idea or more about your plans during the fellowship? And the second question is, what do you think made your application stand out?
You know, I don't think those are either-or questions. I mean, you just decide the balance. I mean, obviously, the idea needs operationalizing, and, you know, there's no kind of magic formula for that, and I'll let Jay and Ted and...
My application was a little funky in that it was, I am writing a second book, and the book is about caregiving. It's a memoir. My father passed of Alzheimer's last year, and I was his primary caregiver for the last 5 years of his life. And he worked for 20 years in the UN, and so he had all these amazing stories from Africa when he was my age, and so it kind of flips back and forth between my experience caregiving and his time when he was my age. But I'm also working on this startup company that grew out of my experience caregiving for my father, and really my application, I don't know if Peter, if you remember this, but it was sort of funky because it was almost more about the startup than it was about the book. I kind of was like, yeah, I'm mentioning the book too, but like, so the startup is about, it's called Memory Well, and it's, put my father into a home a few years ago, and they asked me to fill out a 20-page questionnaire about his life, and I was like, you're never gonna remember 20 pages of handwritten data points for the 150 residents that you have here. Why don't you let me write down a story for you? I'm a journalist. And so I wrote down a story and they loved it. And they were completely transformed his care. And they were like, can you do this for everybody here? So me and a friend from the Wall Street Journal basically started a business on the side writing the life stories of those living with Alzheimer's and dementia called Memory Well. And we have a website where we host the stories and family members can upload their loved ones' favorite music and art and videos and readings. And it's really changing their care. And so I wanted to work on issues holistically around caregiving. And I was really interested in, and technology, because I don't know anything about running a startup, and I don't know anything about about caregiving policy and about, there's like just so many resources that New America had that I really wanted to get hooked up to for Memory Well and for my book. And it's not an area that I've written about extensively when I was in the last 10 years at Time. And so for me, it's like this whole new universe of aging and of caregiving and, but then also of startups and technology and, coding and so it's been a really great, for me, it's just, my application was, really looking at that area and that space I don't know what made them interested in having me on, but I think I did cite a lot of people that I wanted to work with here, and I did look really through New America and say, wow, this person's something I'd like to talk to about this, and this person's someone I'd like to talk to about that, because they had so many great resources.
I think one, the storytelling aspect is a good method to use. When you have to 400 applications, the ones that stand out are the ones that you find a character that you can attach to. So that's what I did in mind. The story I told about my name is what I put in my application, but I balanced it with the academic rigor of from my doctoral work. So I kind of said, look, I'm the only one with this story, and I'm the only one with this data that I use for my dissertation. So I can tell this story in a way that no one else can. The other part of it is, why New America? because I could, you could write the book anywhere. But what New America prides itself on is challenging well-established concepts. So, the America thinks they understand how black people vote, and you could see it in the way it was talked about during the election. And I wanted to challenge the conception of that topic. And so this is a place where I could do it, and I don't have to worry about stepping on someone's toes or offending them because my research is contrary to theirs. And so that gives you a freedom to explore things that in other places you may be more constrained. So being able to sort of distinguish yourself to be a person to tell this story in a particular way, and then why you need to tell that New America and what makes them unique.
Ramesh?
Well, I have no idea what stood out about my application, to be honest, but...
You can't remember it.
Yeah, I can't remember it, right? It's so long ago. But I just remember that I actually was on the selection committee for the fellowship for the following year, in 2011, 2012. And we didn't get 400 applications back then. I think we had about 30, maybe. I mean, 50? I don't know. Maybe I read 30. Maybe they portioned it up. And all I would say is, I treated it the way I did, as a journalist, as an editor. I mean, the applications that stood out were the ones that were well written, that made me want to read more, and that had an element of discovery to them. So, I think a handful of the ones that I liked were the ones that were granted fellowships, but. I think it's as simple as that, really. I mean, my view, but I'm not on the committee anymore.
I think that's a good answer. Yeah, I guess honesty as well. I mean, going to Jay's point about Jay was like, "Oh, I mentioned the people I wanted to work with." That doesn't mean you should just like mention people that you like. She actually wanted to work with them, and that that like not and they're being honest about your strengths and your limitations. I think is generally useful. We didn't. Talk, I mean, this should be self-evident, but just didn't come up, in the sort of a public policy relevance. There may be a very good memoir of, a musician about, how I came to write music. Yeah. That may be a tremendous book, but, isn't a project for here. On the other hand, not just a dry discussion of public policy, which does come in. There has to be some sort of spark of originality for it to work within this program.
Peter, there was a question that was actually submitted online. It's being live streamed, and someone was asking if they applied last year, is it okay for them to reapply this year?
Yes.
And they have noticed that the majority of our current fellows and those that are on stage have published books. This person would prefer to do long form series stories, and is that okay or not?
Yes and yes.
Yeah. Hey, and just to elaborate, evidence of for someone who has applied in the past, evidence of progress in the past year is probably the single most important thing.
And just to underline the diversity, one of my co-fellows from last year is in the crowd. Andrew is writing a musical about policy. So you don't have to write a book necessarily.
Yeah, Andrew's writing a musical about surveillance.
I have a quick, easy question. I think the answer has been given, but I just want to hear it explicitly. If one's objective is to write a book, can the application essentially be in the form of a book proposal, including, very brief paragraph-long chapter outlines, but with some context of the purpose of the book and where it would fit and need both existing literature and policy debate? Does that make sense? I'm thinking.
Yes. 2,500 words is not the classic book proposal, and so I think it can be a little bit more, a little less reductive than that. It's what's the big idea? Why am I the right person? What's the big idea, and why am I the right person to do it? It's two of the big questions that this proposal should answer.
I'm David Borden. I'm with an advocacy group called StopTheDrugWar.org. My question is, what practical terms does a part-time fellowship mean? What range in number of hours, but more importantly, how are people's schedules, how do they tend to be structured, and how does that fit into the environment here?
So I've been a part-time fellow the whole time, and you know, I was writing full-time for Time magazine until 2 months ago. I was promoting a best-selling book. I was covering a campaign, which was kind of intense, but I was also a fellow at New America. So did I make every fellow's lunch? I did not. But I definitely made a fair amount of them, and I mean, there's no minimum and there's no maximum. And it's as much or as little as you need or to take out of it. And so for me, I got a lot out of it just from my cohorts and from other fellows and from past fellows asking their opinions, asking for their connections, asking them for their advice on how to do things that I was really struggling with. And now that I'm full-time, you know, writing my second book and working on my startup, it's really an amazing, you know, resource for me. It's even broader resource than it was in the last year with the first book. So it's as much as you make of it, I think.
Yeah, I work full-time at Deloitte. And I also teach at Georgetown one night a week. But I try to get to work out of New America spaces at least once a week, even if I'm doing other work, just to sort of be here. But that's all optional. But the key is to always find time to work on the thing that you're doing at New America. But that can be a couple of hours a day. It doesn't have to be business hours. It doesn't have to be here on site. It's just, you know, it's as you can make it.
I have two questions. The first is just in terms of topics that you're interested in, is the Trump election affecting kind of the scope? Are you looking for things really tied to the forthcoming presidency? And then my second question is really simple, which is that is it possible to get healthcare through the fellowship beyond a stipend?
Yes and maybe. You know, I mean, obviously the Trump presidency is a subject of great interest and what happened and how it happened. If there were, I mean, you won't be alone in trying to write a book about this. But there will be many good books about this. So, of course, that's of great interest. On the question of healthcare, yeah, we would sort of take that case by case. I mean, if you made a good case, we'd say, okay. You know, we don't automatically offer it because it's we have quite generous benefits, but certainly that's something we would talk about with you.
I'm Catherine Lewis, and my question is also about the application and the proposal itself. It sounds like you're saying make it stand out, make it well written, and I'd love if you could address sort of the balance between, and I don't want to take your exact question, but between writing a piece of, you know, giving a piece of writing that is just compelling in and of itself, and also making the case for the broader project. So if you're sort of weighing the trade-off in just 2,500 words of really grabbing the reader and pulling them in and explaining why it's important, where would you draw that line?
There's really no good answer. I mean, I'm going to turn to our panelists because they went through the process, and you know, Ramesh was writing about a very specific time in a very, you know, in a book of history, and we decided that was sufficiently interesting and that he was the right person to tell the story. So, you know, there's really no formula, unfortunately.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that dichotomy that you set up actually exists, right? Like, there's a trade-off between, I mean, there are trade-offs that are real in the world, and there are trade-offs that are notional. Like, it should be a well-written thing that makes you want to read more. That's what it should be.
Yeah, and I think in my application, I used the word book maybe two or three times. So I didn't really talk about, I said, I want to write a book, and here's the idea. And so I didn't describe what kind of book or the audience for the book or anything about the method of communicating the idea, mostly about the idea.
Yeah, mine as well. It was very personal, my experience with my father. You know, it was very much expressing appall at like how isolating a lot of these homes are and how totally unprepared America is for the baby boomer generation to age out, and just wanting to be the person to ask questions and say, why are people not more alarmed at this? And that's about it.
Hi, Susanna Cunningham. So I have a question. I understand that New America has a California division with the fellowships. I guess I'd want to understand your relationship with that program and the distinction between the one based here and the one in California.
Yeah, well, it's a good question. I mean, the one in California is based in California, so it's really targeted at people who are in California and issues that are of relevance to California, and it's sort of a slightly different conception. It's more recruiting people who are sort of civic entrepreneurs who may be, you know, doing some kind of public policy project, and so it's a slightly different animal. I mean, and the process is different, and this is a national fellowship, that's a California fellowship, so it's really something that's, you know, related but different.
Hi, Sarah Luthwaite. What attitude do you take to joint applications?
We've had some in the past, and you know, we haven't, and we've accepted them, but there has to be some sort of mechanics about the agreement about where the money is going to go. I mean, then I think that should be pretty transparent. If you're talking about applying with a fellow author or some fellow researcher, I think maybe it would be you'd be explicit that you've agreed to whatever you've agreed to, so that we understand what that agreement is.
Hi, Kate Lavender. I'm a national security reporter with a startup called The Cipher Brief. Thank you all for doing this. I'm wondering if any of you during your course here working on the fellowship changed your idea either slightly or drastically, and how do you progress if that happens?
Ted, I think we need to start with you.
Yeah, so mine did change. I came in thinking I was gonna do this great descriptive book about Black voting behavior over time temporally, and that's just too much to bite off. So what I ended up doing, with the help of other fellows and the workshops and the various resources, was narrowing the idea to look specifically at the Black middle class, specifically politics, specifically post-Obama. So absolutely the idea changes, but the core of the idea has not changed. It still remains the same, the focus is the same. It's just the angle of attack has changed a little bit.
But Ted, just expand for a second, because I mean, what is the thesis of the book as it stands right now?
I mean, I'm trying to figure it out. Okay. No. So what I think it is, the current instantiation of my thesis, right, is that the empowerment that Black Americans felt during the Obama elections is now gone with his sort of the descriptive representation, having a Black guy in the White House that no longer exists. But the surrendering of that power is not gonna go quietly. And so you see things like Black Lives Matter and other ways of putting pressure on the system. So my thesis is that the way middle-class Black America tries to address the policy desires of Black America being ignored by the political apparatus, the means they choose will be the means by which America either acknowledges or denies those policy demands. Not how Black Lives Matter chooses to protest. I think it will be the means that the way the Black middle class chooses to express themselves. That whether that acceptance happens or not will tell us about the future of Black America's relationship with the nation. In 200 words or less. Not really.
Andrea Peterson with the Washington Post. So I'm curious about whether or not we should lay out our hopes for funding and our proposals, because I know there's a difference between full-time and part-time funding. Is that something we should state up front in our proposals, or is that something that will be negotiated later?
Yeah, I wouldn't get hung up on that. Because we can help you later, you know.
Good evening. My name is Laura Taylor Acalay, and as a policymaker and sort of practitioner who's not a journalist, who does not have a large body of written work to discuss, inform, and reflect your ideas, I'm very curious what advice you would have about the application process. I noted that you said that you at you had some articles that you'd written and sort of that sort of led sort of like, it was like a little, crumb trail of, what you could possibly provide and how you could be a fellow, but if you don't really have a large body of written work, how do you approach the application process? And do you have people that have been in that
well,
position before?
Ted, you were in that position?
I was. I mean, I did have like a number of op-eds and Atlantic essays and magazine things. But I have nothing that shows I am capable of writing a book. You know, just something that I'm capable of writing out ideas in a way that's interesting. And so I think, I don't think it has to even be published work. You know, in fact, one of the things I submitted was a fictional article, or a fictional short story of like 2,000 words that went into an academic journal. You know, so, but it was related to racial justice, essentially. So, but I think the writing samples are just to show that you can write. If you're going to say, I'm going to write a book or a magazine article, it's just to show that you actually can produce the thing, even if the things you've produced look unlike what you're pitching.
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult to get, say, you know, an op-ed placed in a major newspaper, right? And yet, there are badly written op-eds in major newspapers, you know, every day. So, you know, reading the applications, it's not that we would ever be hung up on, you know, what the brand name attached to the clip is. As Ted mentioned, the writing samples can be published or unpublished, and the people reading them, you know, have confidence in their own judgment and, you know, aren't going to be, oh, this was published somewhere prominent, but it's not. So I think there are very few people who can write well once and not again. So it's sort of, regardless of sort of how, you know, because part of the whole idea of this fellowship is to indeed bring people into, you know, writing and analysis who may have been practitioners who don't have a lot of clips. But if that statement is persuasive, then that's enough, basically.
Thanks for sharing your stories. So my question goes back to sort of the evolution of not so much the idea, but I assume there's flexibility about the end product itself. What if you write about a book and then it sort of morphs into something else like a podcast or a docufilm, et cetera?
Yeah, we're open to all sorts of ways of feature, a series of articles, a book, documentary. We have a graphic artist who's just was named a fellow. So, you know, there are lots of ways to communicate, and we understand that.
And most people's projects change as they develop, you know, I mean, here as anywhere else in the world. So there's not a, you know, a contractual idea of, oh, you said you would do X and now you're doing Y.
I mean, it's flexible. And so I think, so for an example, let's say I said, you know what, I don't want to do a book. I want to do like a cover article for The Atlantic. Would there be?
Yeah, I mean, that would be great.
Yeah.
You seem.
Okay, we'll after you. We'll
great. Okay. I have a feeling you're going to say we're open to everything because that's what you keep saying.
Yeah.
But just to clarify, for people who work internationally, I'm currently working with the Peace Corps in Guinea, and will be for the next year and a half. Are those people also eligible?
Yeah, one of our fellows is based in Beirut.
Thank you.
Yeah, Rania Abuzaid, who's writing a book.
I mean, it is worth maybe just saying the farther away you are, the better reason there has to be for being where you are. I mean, part of what we want to do here is indeed create this community, which is difficult to do if you're in Conakry, but, you know, that's surmountable.
Yeah, and Rania's writing about the Syrian civil war, so being in Beirut makes sense.
I'm Alicia Shepherd. I'm interested in whether or not you are open to documenting things that have happened. Like you said, you wrote about a very specific period of World War II, and I'm not sure how that affects public policy. And
yeah, what was the argument? What was the argument you made at the time?
We should have done it differently.
No, that's a good question. I mean, you know, I'm a believer that. There are lessons to be drawn from history, and that have real impact on current policy challenges. And I mean, I have to think back to my actual essay, but if you think about the last 3 weeks of World War II, I mean, there was a huge number of issues that were adjudicated during that time that had a great bearing on the evolution of the post-war world, and that we continue to grapple with today. I mean, most notably, nuclear weapons. And I mean, the idea that I, you know, was interested in exploring and still am, and I think you know, was sort of the nub of why the book appealed to me, is to explore how wars end and how enemies become friends. I mean, and that to me, especially at sort of the tail end of the Iraq War, was a question that I wanted to explore, and so I felt that the historical prism was a way to get at that current issue. And I think that's true of most good histories. But that's a very specific case. I mean,
so are there many examples of people who have documented things? I'm not sure is this one.
Well, in terms of, Daniel Kurtzfehlin is writing a book about George Marshall's time in China. We've had, trying to think of other typically we don't do a huge amount of history, but we do some, if it seems like a really
Yeah, there's a current fellow, I can't recall his name at the moment, who's doing a history of the economy.
Well, and that's a little more policy related.
It's sort of the things you can draw from documenting how things have been talked about, yeah.
Tim Schenck is his name. He writes very well.
Hi. My name is Milad Jokar. I'm a visiting lecturer at the Normandy Business School in France and contributor to the Huffington Post. I have a question related to international professionals. Do you have fellowships open for non-American citizens?
We do. I mean, so Rania is an Australian-Lebanese citizen, and we had to get a visa for her, which costs money and takes time and is a hassle. So, but for the right person, we'll do it. But it's not something we're just, you know, falling over ourselves to do, because it is, you know, costs money and takes time.
But I mean, just to elaborate that, it's not that we consider citizenship when reading the applications, right? If the application is right, then we'll cross that bridge, you know, when we arrive there.
Hello, I'm Gabriele Barbati. I'm a foreign correspondent with Italian TV. Following up on this, the last question, could a fellow write in a language other than English, especially in a book or long form work?
I think that's very tough for us. I mean, I do. It would have to be, there'd have to be such a good rationale for that, because at the end of the day, this is the New America Foundation. It's not the New France Foundation. I mean, we don't want to be parochial, yet at the same time, it's hard for us to judge on the merits in a language that we're not conversant with, and there'd have to be a really good argument of why that was necessary.
Hi, Sam Skolnick, currently with the Bloomberg BNA, longtime journalist, wrote my first book, 2011, a Beacon Press published it. The reason I mention that is that ever since that book came out, I've been thinking about my second book, but really, because I've been working full-time jobs, haven't had the time to pursue, and I was fortunate enough to get a Knight Wallace Fellowship at Michigan, which really helped me finish the first chapter of my book, as well as the proposal. So this leads to a twofold question. I have a full-time job now, as I'd mentioned. I'm wondering, has that ever proven to be logistically tough, either for the fellow or for the employer? In other words, have you awarded a fellowship, but has the employer balked at giving that fellow any time? And then secondarily, and one of the fellows might have mentioned it, I didn't get her name, I'm sorry, I showed up late, but I'm wondering if the initial part-time fellowship works out well, could that morph into a full-time fellowship to finish up the book continue on with that process if all parties were in agreement that that was a good thing to do?
You know, the answer to the first question is maybe, and the answer to the other questions is, you know, we've had everybody in this current fellowship has other jobs. Sometimes we've had people leave their jobs entirely for a year, and we've supported them. Of course, that's an opportunity cost for us, because we've got to pay more and pay benefits, so, you know, there has to be a good reason for us to think that that's a good idea. And then finally, you know, it's part of the question, like, is it hard to write a book if you have a full-time job? Well, I mean, it can be done, believe me.
Hi, Blake Phillips, board member at the Fulbright Association National Chapter. So my question is, is it possible to not have the project be explicitly about a book, but more about a particular civil society project, one which is focused on political discourse, which would have an effect on public policy and debate. So it's more of a project than a book, than book idea.
Yeah, well, describe it in more detail.
So I guess the idea would be, basically for the Fulbright Association, we create social networks of concurrent and existing Fulbrighters in both the United States and abroad, and basically focusing on trying to increase the amount of discourse and basically just kind of creating networks and creating political discourse, like the opportunity to talk about different discussion series or academic discussion series. And so it's more creating those networks. So it'd be more of a project on that standpoint. I'm still trying to figure it out, but I guess the idea is it okay to have more of a project versus a book, or if it's really designed ideally to be around some sort of academic book?
I mean, yeah, I'm sort of trying to think if we've had people apply who had sort of a project in mind that was similar to what you're saying, and we thought it was interesting. In the end, we didn't give them the money, not because there were other projects. I mean, as we try to make clear, there can be lots of outcomes for your work. And if you can make the case that this is the best kind of outcome to communicate whatever the big idea is, you know, that might be an effective argument, you know, rather than a documentary or a book or a series of articles or a multimedia project, that what you're actually trying to support is this. And if you made the argument in a compelling way, you know, I think we'd be interested. Emma's going back to Andrew. Andrew's doing a musical about the NSA, and you know, that seems on the face of it an absolutely absurd idea, but you know, we thought it was actually a very good idea, and he was the person to do it.
So that was a helpful question that I will sort of trail as well. You say here that you support books, films, or other projects of similar scope. So a musical perhaps might fit in with a similar scope of those, the like other two categories. So if the project is a group, an initiative, something that lasts far beyond, maybe has a sort of extended longevity, does that fit in with what you say is something of a similar scope?
I mean, the same answer I just gave. I mean, you're asking the same question, I'm answering the same way. But you have to present it in a way that makes it a compelling argument. We're not precluding it.
I noticed that your materials mentioned that you don't already have to have a contract with a publisher in order to apply for a fellowship. I'm curious about, does it weigh against your decision? And also, does the foundation help authors connect to publishers? I would imagine if you say you're a fellow, that helps in a deal, but
part of our job is to connect you to agents or publishers, or yeah, really the sequence is connect you to an agent, because then they can get you a publisher. And that is part of our job. And we don't, as you know, Ted came without a book contract.
I don't have a book contract for my second book.
Right. So, you know, it's certainly not, it's exactly as we state. You don't have to have one, and you don't have to be writing a book.
I think a friend of ours who's a publisher at a major publisher, editor of a major publishing house, described to me, she described New America as the best incubator for serious nonfiction in America. And I think what she meant was that it's, there are just a lot of people here whose projects have not been discovered necessarily by you know, a large publisher, but who, by virtue of being here and interacting with others here, develop ideas that are incredibly compelling and marketable. And so I would say that, you know, once you get in the door, you'll have a lot of people who you'll find are interested in the work you're doing.
Any other questions? In which case, Alicia?
Can I ask the second one?
Yeah.
Is anyone up there open to having someone run an idea by them, or do you just have to give it your best shot?
No, please. I mean, that's part of our job. So please run it by Wister or myself or Constantine, or we can.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
So with that, I want to thank Ramesh and Ted and Jay and Constantine, all of whom have busy day jobs and volunteered to do this. thank everybody for coming, and good luck with the application if you choose to do it.